Small business war stories. Small businesses are the soul of America. And this is where they tell their stories. I am your host, Pablo Fuentes. Hey, small business people and lovers of good stories in general. Welcome to episode 550 of Small Business War Stories. That is really, really cool. We are two episodes away from being 1 year into our podcasting adventure, where I have taken it upon myself with my puppy Muddy Waggers to drive. I think we've logged close to 10,000 miles so far this year, all over the country, talking to different small business owners, listening to their cool stories, their lessons. And I'm writing a book about it coming up, so keep an eye out for that. But today's episode is really cool. I sat down with Tod Moore, who is one of the founders and partners at Atomic Athlete in Austin, Texas. And I met Tod through Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He trains at the academy I train. But I also signed up for his gym, for Atomic Athlete, which is it's not exactly for the faint of heart. They definitely push you very, very hard, but they make you just a little bit better every time, and they help your fitness, your mental strength. We talk a lot about all those things and what they mean within the context also of being a small business. And Tod is a very, very entertaining guy. He's he brought a bottle of wine to the podcast, which definitely helped. He points out, makes the conversation flow. So he's actually an aspiring podcaster himself. I believe actually, no, not aspiring. That definitely a podcaster. I believe their podcast is already live. So you can find him as Tod Moore, Tod Moore. And I'll put this show in the show notes. But yeah, Todd's great. And this episode is brought to you by Proven, proven.com. Proven is a company I started, and it's meant to help small businesses hire. So if you're looking to hire anybody for your small business and you don't know where to start, you can come to proven.com, post your job. We distribute it to over 100 job boards and help get you all your candidates in one place. We go out there and act like little headhunters for you, getting you the folks you need. We're not actually headhunters. It's a software tool, but you know what I mean. We also have a lot of really good resources on blog.proven.com. We are really, really excited to be a content destination, a place where you as a small business can come learn, a place that is a trusted place for you to come learn more from other small business owners all over the land. So we'll be rolling out a lot of really cool new features in the new year with blog.proven.com. So check it out. Without further ado, I want to get into today's episode number 550 with Tod Moore of Atomic Athlete in Austin, Texas. And we are live here in beautiful Austin, Texas. And this afternoon, I have the honor to sit down here with Tod Moore, co-owner of Atomic Athlete. Welcome to the show.
Appreciate you having me, man.
Yeah, cheers. First of all, thank you so much for bringing this bottle of wine. It's a bottle of Chilean wine.
Right? Yeah, man. That's you gotta have some vino to podcast.
Sounds good. I think this is a first for wine. It's definitely not a first for booze. There's been some weird stuff that's happened before, but it's first for wine.
We did a few sober podcasts, and then we did a few non-sober podcasts, and man, it's a little bit easier to be chatty when you've had a few drinks.
Yeah, yeah. There's probably some sort of a curve, right? Like after a couple of drinks, better podcast.
It's like everything.
After four or five drinks, not so good at podcasts.
It's like everything. We did a little tequila challenge where we did a few shots of tequila and did some back squats, and it works until it doesn't. You know, it definitely works until it doesn't. It's definitely one of those things where you're like, don't try this at home because I probably won't do it again. But it's worth playing with.
It's kind of like lifting cowboy boots, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. You can do it once.
Exactly. Until you can't do it anymore.
Until you can't do it.
Cool. Let's talk. So I have the privilege of training with you guys. So I know a little bit about your methodology and all that. But I'd love to highlight some of the things that make you different. So Let's talk a little bit about Atomic Athlete and what makes you different from other gyms and other training facilities.
So the biggest thing that we kind of strive and what sets us apart is that there is no randomness in anything we do. Everything has purpose. And our main goal is not a 30-day challenge or a 60-day challenge or to give you abs or anything like that. I mean, our tagline says it, we make people stronger, faster, and harder to kill. And that seems like a very aggressive thing to say and put on the back of a t-shirt, but at the end of the day, that's our ultimate goal, because like it's coming for you. It might be diabetes, it might be a rando in a back alley, it might be, you know, a blown out knee, but your day is coming. And the more fit you are, the more prepared you are for those things when they do come. And when we were first getting established, our mindset and what we did definitely set us apart, and it did not attract people towards us, because we don't view fitness as a challenge. We don't view fitness as a competition. We view fitness as a training ground, and right. Your proving ground is everything outside that gym.
Right.
And so that's our main differentiator, is there's no random programming, there's no random training. We don't believe that you can get fit that way. We know you can't. I mean, science goes against it. You know, we back most of our methodologies up with training principles from high level strength athletes and high level aerobic athletes, guys that have put in the work. And that's kind of what set us aside and has brought the athletes, brought you to us, and brought the athletes that we currently have.
Cool. What came first? Was it the strong, faster, stronger, harder to kill, and then let's start a gym around that, or what was it like you guys, you know, started? So you and your business partner Jake started this, right?
Yeah. So me and Jake and I and two other guys, basically a guy I met Jake through another guy. We all lived in a house in Austin, and we just worked out every day. So we'd go, there's a local buddy of ours, a guy that used to have a running store called Runtex, and we'd go and he'd do these free running workouts. And they were really challenging workouts. You'd run up hills, you'd do all these sprints, you'd do all this crazy stuff. So we'd ride bikes to these running workouts. We'd train with Paul. And then we'd leave there, we'd come home, we'd rest up for a little bit, and then we'd go to noon jiu-jitsu or MMA, and we'd get back and we all bartended. So we'd work nights. And that's what we did for about a year. And as we started to develop this level of fitness, jiu-jitsu got easier, right? Because we were the fitter guys. And as we did other things, we were always the fit guys. We didn't quite fit in with any one group. And then it was just education at that point. We've got a book by a guy named Ross Enemant, and I can't remember the name, but this is an old boxing coach from way back, and he had these work capacity methodologies for like the working man, because CrossFit was just getting popular. This was probably 2007, 2008, but for us, CrossFit was a high level of buy-in. You needed equipment, and you needed to know how to do Olympic lifting, and you needed to do all this stuff that we didn't know how to do at the time.
Yeah.
And this guy had, you know, build your own sandbags and do this and do that, and it was all work capacity, which is basically breathing. And real heavy, you know, interval stuff. And we would just smoke dudes. And we would, you know, our group of friends were our training partners, and that's who we train with.
Yeah.
And as we took it further and further, more people started to kind of show up. And I moved to Thailand for a while and trained Muay Thai out there. And in the interim of doing that, Jake started to do a little bit of group training. And when I came back, he had a group of athletes, you know, just regular type dudes, friends of ours that were training out in the park. And I showed up and helped out. And we just eventually, a few more people showed up and a few more people showed up, and we would nickel and dime equipment. And I mean, when I say we bootstrapped, I mean, it was rusty dumbbells, rusty barbells in the back of a Suburban that we would unload and write the workouts in chalk on the concrete at Butler Wow. Park. And
there's something sexy about that. Would you guys still do that once in a while?
Nah.
Throwback workout.
They ask about it for a long time. We still have some original athletes. So we've been around. We really got going in about 2009, and we still got some original athletes.
So you're 8 years in now?
Yeah. And wow. It's eight years as a business. We were. Can I cuss?
Yeah.
We were fucking around for a little bit.
All right. We'll tag it.
Yeah, okay.
Which means you'll be banned in India. So nobody in India will hear this.
Well, that's unfortunate. but that was, it was just a slow growth model. You know, that was, that same guy that we ran with, Jake said it one day, he goes, I want that guy's job. He just shows up in short shorts and he works out all day, and that's what he does, you know? And that was kind of the driving force behind it. And we found a mentor that had a company in Jackson, Wyoming, and we went and did some certs with him, and he really showed us that you can do it a different way. You don't have to do it the CrossFit way, or you don't have to do it the Globo Gym way. And he taught us how to program and what it was to program, which is basically identifying fitness attributes, individual fitness attributes, and bringing those up one at a time. So, and that's the struggle that we have and we had forever is everybody wants to get jacked and get a six pack and then put 40 pounds on their back squat and get their black belt in jiu-jitsu and then run a 4 minute mile. And you can do it all. You just can't do it all right now, you know? And that was the biggest point of just being disciplined with all this stuff. And this guy showed us a lot of right ways to do things. And through that, we saw a lot of wrong things too. It's part of finding a mentor, right? Yeah. You know, you do what they do right, and then you cut out what they do wrong. And that's kind of how you establish it. But he was incredibly helpful for us at the time. I went and worked out there for about a year. Jake worked out there. Our other partner, Jordan, worked out there for a couple of years. So it was a really good vetting process to kind of see those things. And then when we came back, it just the gym just evolved from that. And when we bootstrap, I mean, we still bootstrap. It's just we never borrowed a dollar.
So let's talk about a little bit. I want to get back to the bootstrapping part because I think that's really relevant to a lot of small business owners. Mm-hmm. I do want to chat a little bit about the programming part since you were just talking about it. How do you, in a world where you constantly have a new fad, a new thing, how do you differentiate between innovation and faddish behavior and things that don't necessarily lead to long-term sustainable growth for athletes?
So the biggest issue that we have is the internet. Because everybody, everybody comes in with a preconceived idea of what they need to do to be fit. So I'll use our friend Tim Kennedy, for instance. So Tim's a UFC fighter. He's a great guy. And Tim's a freak. And Tim has a body that normal human beings don't have. And people see Tim like, if I do what Tim does, I'll look like Tim. You know, and that's not true. Tim has a gifted genetics. Not to take anything away from Jim. Tim works really, really hard. But in the same instance, that's our biggest hurdle that we have.
You're saying that if you and I were to do all the things that Tim does, we would not look like Tim.
We still wouldn't look like Tim. We're just not going to look like Tim. You've wrestled Tim. It's a very sad, unfortunate thing. You know, it's like you're a better man than me. You know, but that's the biggest thing we have to get over. That hurdle is people come in and everybody thinks it's going to be fast and everything. Everybody thinks it's going to be easy. And it's just like money and relationships and everything else. It's one brick at a time, day in and day out. What really worked out for us initially is because we program, because we know exactly what our athletes are doing day in and day out, that allowed us to limit injuries. So if we saw something that consistently hurt an athlete, we cut that thing out or we modified it or changed it. So the number one reason you lose athletes other than motivation is injury. You just lose them. We cut out the injury component, so we stopped losing athletes there. So then we just had a higher base of athletes. Then other people would come in and they're like, well, I think I should do it this way or this way. It's like, that's fine, but we've been doing it this way for a long time. This is our proven stock athletes that do it, and they don't get hurt, and they're stronger than you, and they're more fit than you, and they're doing these things that you don't want to do, but that's what's bringing them up. Yeah. So eventually, just the athletes spoke for themselves. And even now, I mean, our guys go to competitions, and they do really, really well, especially our women, because they're just so much stronger than a lot of the other women out there. And it's just that there's nothing sexy about it. You know, my other business partner, Jordan, says you can't flex mitochondrial density in the mirror, and that's why it's not very popular, which is basically running slow and long. But we figured out ways to do it. But
That must be what you're working on now, because last week we did these like absurd, like, hey guys, you're going to work 52 minutes nonstop or something like that.
Yeah, just a slow, chill pace, you know. But that was a big thing for us too, is nobody's going to pay me to tell them to go run for 52 minutes. So we had to figure out formulas, and we had to figure out systems that allowed us to train and develop these fitness traits. And that's the biggest thing, is we identified the fitness traits we want to train, and then we progressively train those traits through the course of a year. And that's the other thing that keeps the athletes coming back, is you're doing something you don't like sometimes, but then you get to do something you like. And then you come back to something you don't like, and then you do something you like. And then you come back to that thing you didn't like, but now you're better at it. So you like it, you know, and that's part of it. But it was a hard process initially. Nobody wanted to do what we did. Everybody wanted to do sexy, hard workouts that they could post online. Nobody wanted to do drudgery work, you know, what I call drudgery workouts, but it's basically, you know, establishing a wide base of fitness.
But it also gives you a lot of mental toughness, right? Because it's like it allows you to push beyond where you thought. Because if you had told me, you know, I guess I've been doing some kind of like jiu-jitsu or fitness for like a lot better part of a half decade. But if I walked in without any of that and you told me that I was going to do 42 or 52 minutes straight work, I would probably tell you that's not going to happen. But mm-hmm. then you are basically able to train the mind to become stronger to the point where it just becomes like you just put one foot in front of the next one.
The mental resilience component is huge. And we've gone back and forth with that. Like we used to really, really push mental toughness. And then we kind of found out that mental toughness is a lie. It limits you because a tough guy, and you know some tough guys, right? They can put their head down and they can walk through a wall. You don't have to walk through a wall. Sometimes you can just get up to that wall and take two steps to the left and walk around it, you know? And that's the issue we noticed with really tough guys is that head would go down and they would never look left and they would never look right. They would just go straight ahead. And it's like, okay, you're tough and that's good, but you also need to figure out a resilience component with that. You need to recognize what's going on. And that allowed us to, as we develop that principle more and more, where it's not just about being tough, it's being smart, it's listening to your body and understanding, hey, like, this sucks. Why does this suck? Why am I miserable right now? Am I miserable because I'm not fit? Am I miserable because I stayed up last night drinking vodka? Do I have an injury? What's going on right now that's making this so hard? Yeah. Am I just having a pity party? You know, is this an internal thing?
Talk about that, because you guys had a great article that's helped me a lot with my mental game. That had exactly to do with that, which is, it was titled, I'm going to butcher this, but it's something along the lines of nobody's going to feel sorry for you.
Yeah, I mean, it's well, everybody that comes into the gym to work, right? Yeah. So if you're, and this is, I say this over and over again, man, nobody's feeling sorry for you when you're working because they're all working. Nobody has time to feel bad for you. You shouldn't even have time to feel bad for yourself. It's that internal locus control. Like, I don't want to do this. I'm miserable. I'm upset. And it's like, you have to go back to, why are you doing it? If you can come back to that fundamental, like the why am I training? I'm training because, so for you, I'm training because I want to be stronger. I want to be more resilient and I want to be a motherfucker on the mats. You know, when I get
jiu-jitsu was a big motivation for me.
Big motivation for other people. It's health. For my soldiers, it's to live, you know, all my Green Berets and those guys. I mean, it's for everybody, but we work, one of our other companies, we do a lot of training with Green Berets and SF guys. And we talked to SOSEP, which is their site board, the guys that kind of work with them and see their stress levels. And I talked to one of their guys, his name's Ian. And I was like, what gets guys through? And he goes, motivation, man. He goes, and it's not the motivation you think it is. Like, you know, I have to be motivated to work out. It's like, I'm doing this to achieve a goal. You know, and that's why I'm doing all these things. So, and that's why the training again becomes so important, because our training is specifically identifying something that you need to improve on. So, you know, you might not like it, but it's something you're not good at. And what the best way to make things easier is to not suck at stuff. You don't have to be the best, but you don't want to be the worst. I call it the I don't want to win more. I just want to lose less. You know,
like makes that's sense. and also, you know, not underestimating the value of showing up and sucking just a little bit less every day. Right?
That there's nothing more important than showing up. That's it. Like I say it over and over and over again, a day will not make you and it can break you, but not showing up will definitely break you. And that's across the board with anything. It doesn't matter what it is. You know, if you take time off, it's taking time off, you know?
Yeah. And one of the things that's also helped me at Atomic is gratitude for pain, in the sense that, like, remember the first time I showed up during your hardest fitness test of the year or something like that. Mm-hmm. And you just kind of like smirk. And I didn't bring running shoes and it was a running heavy thing. So I was running in chucks.
Good teaching moment.
Yeah. And one of the things I remember thinking then was, you know, everybody's had moments where they've almost died for some reason or another. And I, you know, which moments is not important right now, but I remember thinking particularly like those moments, like, you've already died. Imagine that you died in one of those moments, and this is gravy. You're able to do this, and you are, you know, you should feel the gratitude that you are able to get out there. And even if you're sucking, you know, get out there and suck.
Yeah. I mean, it's huge. Your body will stop working, you know, like it's inevitable. I'm 40, I'm about to be 41, and I could still consider myself a handful, but there's things I can't do now that I could do 2 years ago that I just can't, my body won't let me do certain things. And you can dwell on that fact, like I can't do those things, or it's like, okay, I appreciate the fact that I could do those for a while and now I'm doing something else. Does that make me less of an athlete or less of a coach or less of a person? No, because I've found other ways to kind of present that. But you will, if you don't do it, it stops happening. It doesn't matter if it's your body, your cash, or your brain, man. If you don't work those things, they stop working. I mean, I don't know if you've ever taken a break from school, but I took a long break from school and tried to go back, and I was so overwhelmed because I had lost the basic skills just to study and the discipline to do those things.
Yeah.
And it's so, I mean, you and I talked about it the other day, just even things like learning how to sleep, learning how to feed yourself, you know. And it's not hard. None of it's hard. It's just discipline, and it's day in and day out. And it's just laying a foundation for a lot of those things. When the habits are there, and it's when it's, you know, because I haven't been motivated to work out in years or train. Like, I train because I want to be a handful on the mats, and I want to be, it's representative of what I do. I look at it like brushing my teeth. Right. Yeah. So I can skip a few days of brushing teeth and I'll be all right. Skip a few months of brushing teeth, you're going to have a few issues. Skip a few years of brushing teeth, you're going to have some real issues. Same thing with your fitness, man.
Yeah.
You can avoid it for a little while and it's okay. You can get away with it. You can squeak by, right? But eventually he's going to come knocking.
Let's tie that all to like what it's like to be a small business owner. Because a lot of those same things, right? So developing discipline, developing the processes, developing skills that are specific, maybe doing things you suck at and you don't want to do. How does that translate to you running a small business, and how have you evolved as a small business owner because of that?
I think the single biggest one is having partners. Like, my partner is so badass. Both my partners are so badass, and they're so badass at what they do. And it's the ability to communicate with those guys on an equal playing field. So we fight. We're brothers. We fight. We've been friends for a long time. But it's a very interesting component, because what are we fighting about? So you have to establish that, like, I'm not, when they criticize me, they're not criticizing me personally. We're trying to make the business better. So right. I have to take my ego out of the equation and which is hard, super hard. I'm a grown man that, you know, we do stuff with our body, we do all these things. But it's like, okay, no, you're not criticizing me. You're trying to improve me, to improve our business, to improve our lifestyle, to improve everything we do.
Yeah.
So our ability to like have clean lines of communication, for instance, if we start to fight via text, we just stop texting.
Yeah.
Because it's pointless. It just makes you mad. Same thing with email. It's like, no, you have to pick up the phone. If it's worth it, you have to pick up the phone, you know, or you go meet face to face. The other thing we have is, you can't bitch for the sake of bitching. If you don't have a solution, then this is how it is. Right?
Right.
And that solves a lot of problems.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't like this. What's your solution? I don't have one. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah. To build on that, one of the things that I've done with Proven, with my company, is one of the things I always tell our employees and our team is, you attack ideas, not people.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to have like put ideas out there and then test them. And like, you know, in God we trust, everybody else bring data.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you can kind of like go from there, but so that people don't feel like it's like their idea getting attacked, and to avoid like the hippo, the highest paid person's opinion from winning out, just kind of like having like a meritocracy of ideas.
It's a struggle though. It's because it's ego. So it's hard to accept criticism.
Yeah.
And as soon as you realize like this is huge. That guy had to go out of his way to criticize me. He had to like stop and think about it and like present it. Not like, hey, that's a stupid shirt, but like, hey, man, have you thought about doing it this way? Where it's like, you took time out of your day to improve something.
Yeah.
You know, and that's to like, it's
and not, you risk some social political capital too.
Right, right. All those things. So I mean, that I would say to go back to it, establishing communication at a base level was one of the single biggest things that really helped us out as a business. And you know, and it's
and some of your ground rules for that are, when something gets heated, pick up the phone.
Yeah.
So don't fight over text or email. Any other lessons and things that?
The big one is don't bitch for the sake of bitching. Like, you need to have solutions when you come into a situation.
Okay.
And
so no crying and throwing your arms up.
No, and we don't really do that. It's more one of those like, well, I don't like that. And it's like, okay, what solution do you have? So, but what that's created is now when it's like, oh, I don't like that. These are my three options. you know? So then it's like, oh, okay, I never thought about that. But that's not to say we didn't get into knockdown, drag-out fights for a long, long time.
That makes sense.
It's also the belief that everything is moving the company forward, right? I'm not here for me. We're here for them. You know, and that's a big, big component, because the majority of what we're still a customer service industry, and it's real easy for us to get righteous because we're educated and we're and this is what we've done for a long time. So when you have somebody come in and they're like, well, I want to do it this way or this is my thing. And it's like, well, that's wrong. Well, that's not an answer. You know, you have to give somebody an answer, and then you still have to bring in like, well, you know, you're paying me for a service. I need to provide you with the best service I possibly can.
Right.
And it's hard, you know, it's hard sometimes. I get aggravated with athletes. Sometimes they get aggravated with me, and it's just one of those like, no, I'm here to provide you a positive training experience. I'm here to provide you the best coaching I can give you in a safe environment, a super safe environment, right?
Yeah.
Because lifting heavy weight is scary. Pushing your body past a point that you thought you could push your body is scary. And we see people break down. I see people get hurt. I see those things. You know, I've had people cry. I've had people throw up. I've had all those things happen. Now, I'm a good enough coach now. It doesn't happen a whole lot. I could catch it ahead of things. But that belief is, we're sitting down, you know, we got in an argument the other day about how often we should let athletes train. Athletes want to train 6 days a week. And we know that that's not safe, but we have athletes that want to do it. So it's like, how can we find this compromise that appeases the athletes, but we know it's still, our number one rule is you can't injure an athlete. So sometimes you have to save them from themselves. And it's, how do you do that thing? This ended up being an hour heated discussion amongst me and three of my partners and our other employee.
Yeah,
and
I think it's a worthwhile conversation.
It's a worthwhile conversation to have. And it's one of those ones where it's like, we didn't really find a ton of resolution in it other than the fact that we're all in agreement that we want the best for the athlete.
Now, so what's the rule?
Well, we found an ultimate compromise, is that we will provide an additional session for them. We'll just control the volume and the intensity on it. So that
you have people who want to train six times a week.
Five times a week is kind of they'll sneak it in. So what we've realized, because the gym's open 6 days a week, people will sneak in sessions, right? So our programming is built on 3 to 4 sessions a week, and these are progressed sessions. So just for your audience, ultimately, to establish fitness, you need to have a baseline. You need to know where you're starting. Every week or so, you need to do between 2.5% and 5% more, either volume or intensity. And then every 3 to 4 weeks, you take a little break, and then you start over again. And as you depend, and that's just a linear periodization model that you can do with aerobic, strength, work capacity. It doesn't matter. We do it with everything, which is then periodization. So you're rotating those things in a manner. But people want to do hard work every day. I will say that's my only knock on CrossFit. I think CrossFit's great. I think it did wonders for women. It did wonders for putting barbells in people's hands, but it made people believe that if they weren't laying on the ground crushed and sweating and almost throwing up, they didn't get a good workout. And that's wrong. It's very, very wrong.
Yeah, there are some unfortunate caricatures that they have of like pukey and
it's, I understand it initially, you know, it's the same thing where it's like, oh, this is, It's hardcore.
Yeah,
it's hardcore.
It's gonna suck.
Yeah.
Embrace the suck. Right?
Yeah, embrace the suck. Which the suck is discipline. It's not one hard workout.
Right.
That's what we were talking about earlier. It's not one session. It's everything. It's discipline of putting those sessions in.
That makes sense.
And it's hard to communicate that, but that falls back on us to educate our athletes as well. And I think we do a pretty good job of that. We could always do better.
Yeah.
But we really try to make sure that you know what you're doing and why you're doing it and what's going on outside the gym and all those other components.
Between all the shit that I have to do for this podcast and for the company and jujitsu and yoga, I won't show up six times a week.
Yeah. You're not who I'm worried about.
Yeah.
And you know, and it's
yeah. You know, if I make it twice, three times, I'm like, that's a huge victory.
That's all you need, though.
Yeah.
So that's a big thing. So fitness, money, all those things, after you've got it established and it's a habit, it doesn't have to be your life. So for most people, it's the biggest thing.
Yep.
But after you have those things, and it's not much, it's just making that small deposit every day, every other day, making that thing happen. Mm-hmm. After you have that habit, then 1, 2, 3 days a week, those fitness, that stuff's established and you have it. You're good. you know?
Yeah. No, you guys are great. I mean, today I bought the smallest pants that I bought since I was 13 years old. So
that's a good thing.
Let's talk a little bit about the culture that you are building there, because it's you're definitely making choices that bring people together in some ways, but could be alienating in others. So, mm-hmm. for example, the shirts, mm-hmm. right? So you have shirts that say you have your motto, the stronger, faster, harder to kill. And you have things like Lex Feed the Wolf. But then you start getting into things that could be considered maybe like aggressive or bro-y, like swole is the goal, size is the prize, things like that. How do you make those choices? Because those choices affect your culture at your gym, and you have a great feel of the culture at the gym, and everybody's really supportive of each other. Mm-hmm. And I've trained in a number of different barbell-based gyms, and I would say like it has a very collegial, like everybody's there to work, like nobody drags each other down. Like I don't feel, even though I'm like, you know, in the bottom quartile strength there, I don't feel like I'm looked down upon mm-hmm. for that. You know, it's like, if anything, like people encourage each other and things like that. So how do you make those choices and figure out, you know, how to build that culture?
So the first thing is we removed competition from the gym. It's like I was saying earlier, the gym is, and we've said this over and over again, don't have a board. We don't have PR boards. We don't have anything. We don't race. We don't race against the clock. We do interval work. We do progressions. We do things like that. So when you remove,
I hadn't noticed that until
it's huge. It's huge because you can't compete in the gym. You can't, I mean, you can, but that's all you do. If you compete in the gym, if it's important for you to win the gym, you need to talk to somebody. You got some other shit going on, right? It's like jujitsu. If you have to tap everybody you roll with, otherwise you had a bad day, you ain't going to be doing jujitsu very long.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And cause nobody's going to roll with you. Yeah. Right. So you have to do what you can do,
right,
and understand what you can do. So removing competition was huge for us. That was not recognizing PR boards. And then just that sense of community, where what's recognized in that gym? Hard work. And what's the reward for hard work? More hard work,
yeah.
Right? And so that runs a lot of people off. So we've gotten incredibly high-level athletes in that gym, and they want to be recognized for being high-level athletes. And it's like, hey, man, you're just a, you know, you did nothing more. That soccer mom, I'm way more impressed with her performance than yours. Now, I would never say that to them, but she's getting all this encouragement. She's getting all these things. And it's like, no, man, it's the effort she put forth. You know, and if you're putting forth hard effort, that's great. But it's what we've noticed with competition is it brings out the worst in people. It does not, you know, if it's a competition, that brings out the best in people. But if you compete every day, it just breeds bad habits. People cut reps. You lose perspective of what hard is, right? Because if you're going to compete, if you're willing to compete, that means you're willing to get injured. You're willing to do whatever it takes to win that day. And if you're not willing to do that, you shouldn't be competing. You should be training, which is totally fine. I don't compete on the mats too often because I don't want to get hurt, you know. Yeah. Like I need to, like, and but I know every time I do, not only is it a possibility, I need to be okay with it.
Yeah,
right, if it happens.
But you compete in July, right?
I do
at the tournament that I saw you there.
Yeah, I do, but I do it very rarely. It's not a common thing.
You got to meet my mom.
Yeah. But it's the same thing with there's an Olympic lifter named Dmitry Klokov, and I don't know if he's this wildly sexy Olympic lifter. He's incredibly strong, incredibly handsome. He's been on Russia's Dancing with the Stars, and he said, I one rep max once every 4 years because I'm gonna be injured for 2 years after I do it, and those 4 years are the Olympics, right? So that's it. He competes once every 4 years because he knows he can't for 2 years after that. And I think about that a lot.
Wow, that's intense.
Yeah, and that's the level that that's training. You know, that's not working out. So establishing that culture of hard work is the first thing. And the t-shirts are pretty interesting because the harder to kill, that was a very aggressive t-shirt to start with. And especially with our women clientele when they were first coming in, we had a few older ladies, and they're like, I can't wear that shirt. I can't wear that.
I think that's one of the tamer ones.
Yeah, it is now.
Okay, got it. So,
it is now, but back then it was a big deal. And we made that shirt we called it an airport shirt. Like I want, when I walk through an airport, I want to see how many people will say something to me. You know, that was, cause that's the only advertising we do. We don't do any other advertising other than t-shirts. And, but after a while they earned it. they would come up and they're like, I'm ready for a shirt. I'm ready to do this.
That's cool.
You know, I'm ready for it. And so then they embrace it, and then it's what they do, you know. The other t-shirts, bring back natural selection is probably our most aggressive one right now.
Yeah.
And people love it. People absolutely love it. Because people that get it, get it. People that don't.
I got into a debate with my dad about that shirt. It's probably beyond the scope of this podcast. Yeah. My dad's a biologist, so he actually started talking about the meaning of natural selection.
Right. We get it, right? Yeah. But most of that stuff's tongue-in-cheek, too. Yep, but again, you know, our shirts are supposed to be fun for the most part, you know, and it's and you can read into them what they are. And there's a little bit of a bro-y component to it. Swole is the goal and size of the prize. We did those as a joke. I did not think they would be as popular as they were. They were really popular. So, you know, who do I know?
But the women at the gym are they feel very, very, I mean, first of all, a lot of them are extraordinarily impressive, but they also feel like they're very like inclusive and included and part of the community and seen as like, if not equal, sometimes more impressive than the men.
Our women we have far exceeded the point of physicality or capabilities with our women. I mean, it's so we work with a lot of Green Berets, and those guys come in and it's, they have to train with the athletes 3 days a week, and they, you know, these guys are they're badasses. They're good at what they do, and they're not too used to getting crushed by a 35-year-old soccer mom. And we have a bunch of 35-year-old soccer moms that just dish out ass whoopings, you know, like a woman that is stronger than you and faster than you.
There's plenty of those. Yeah.
and they're pleasant. There's no ego involved in that. Nice. They're there to train, you know, but you know, when you have a woman like Tanya that can jump on a bar and do 30 dead hang pull-ups, you know, most men struggle at 12 and you have a woman that can do 30 and it's just like, okay, that's different.
What percentage of the gym people are women?
Probably less than 20.
Okay.
Yeah. It's still mostly males. It's, We don't have exact stats. We probably should, but it's mostly males. But we still, the women that do start don't leave. None of our athletes really leave. It's a pretty interesting component. Yeah. You know, after you make it through the initial, like, this is a lot. I don't know what's going on. When you establish that habit, they're there.
I think a big part of that has to do with the aspect of building community. So you do other events. There's a Facebook group called Outside Atomic, and there are other things. What kind of things have you done to foster that and make people feel like they're part of that community?
So a big one was, my partner, Jake's fearless in everything he attempts, which is such an admirable quality, because I'm not. But he, one of the first things he did was night ops, which he wanted to do a nighttime event under load that was a little militaristic, but mostly it wasn't the best athlete. It was a little challenging for the brain.
Yeah,
you know?
I've done a go-ruck challenge. Yeah. Similar to that.
So this one is, it's about anywhere between a 5 to a 10 mile race, depending on how you run it.
Yep.
And there's a lot of riddles involved and there's some physical things, and it's just kind of a hard, fun event. So that was one of the first things that kind of brought people in. And then from there, the gym started as our friends, you know, and even to this day, every friend I have is an old training partner.
Yep.
And we like to shoot and we like to camp and we like to do all these things. So we started as just an early group of guys. We'd go to these shooting courses together and come back and, you know, with no belief that, you know, we're going to be G.I. Joes or anything, but it's good to have good comprehension with a weapon. And then we, same thing with jiu-jitsu. So, you know, it's establishing that groundwork, and it's like, okay, these people are still working together and you're figuring out these things. And then Vanguard happened.
You want to talk about the Vanguard?
Yeah, we'll talk about the Vanguard for a little bit. Yeah. Vanguard's a pretty good thing.
I was in the last Soul of America podcasting trip. I was very bummed that I missed the Vanguard.
It's a pretty cool event. I've done a few other, like, so it's a man, we'll just real quick overview. It's a 2.5 day man camp. So we have this beautiful ranch out in like a little northeast of here, and it's a really nice setup. There's a bunch of rifle ranges on there. There's rappelling towers. It's just a massive piece of property. It's a mountain biking course. There's a military O course out there. They've got dive rigs. They've got everything. They even have an RPG range. Not that we can shoot RPGs, but they exist out there. And so the guy that owns it's super friendly, and we met him at a competition out there years ago. And Jake and an SF buddy of his were talking one time about a man camp, how much fun it would be to have a man camp. And we started it 1 year, and it was this year it was handguns, small game butchery. So a guy.
Let's pause it for one second. Hold on.
Ice cream man.
Yeah.
the pickup is intense because I couldn't figure out what was going on earlier, and I was like, oh, I think that was your neighbors running water earlier, right?
Yeah. I'll edit that.
All right.
I just want to make sure that you don't, like, that's a really cool part of the podcast. So, yeah. All right, so I'm going to, like, clap so I can mark the word it is. All right, so after a short pause for
Ice Cream Man.
So you were talking about the Vanguard, and
so this year Vanguard was pistol, and it was different pistol groups, but it worked all the way up from beginning shooters, people that had never held a weapon, to people that were very comfortable with a weapon, and they did some running and gunning, moving around, shooting around obstacles, moving, just added stress to the tool. We had rappelling off of a 100-foot tower, which is always an eye-opening experience. They ran the O course, which is a military O course, which is physically challenging, and it's scary because it's got deals with a lot of heights, ranger rope, things like that. We had butchery, so small game butchery. So we had a guy come out and he brought some feral hogs. We killed and butchered these hogs in a humane manner. So everybody had hands on. I think we had 11 or 12 hogs out there that they got to break down, broke those animals down. And then with that, we did some tissue stuff to see what a bullet does to live tissue, which was a lot of people just did not know what a 9mm round did, what a 45mm round did. And then with that, if you do an IFAC on somebody, because we had lungs out, so they were able to put a trach in and expand the lungs. It's like, hey, this is when you do CPR, this is what's happening. So people could see that. Then we had a trauma med class. We had knife fighting with a gentleman named Leslie Buck. We had hand-to-hand combat with our friend Randy Vera, and then we had jiu-jitsu and ground fighting with Donald Park, and it was just a big old party, you know, lots of beer drinking tonight. We had a night event.
And you don't have to be a member of Atomic.
No.
So anybody can sign up for
this. And again, I've been to some of these that are a little militia-y and stuff like this. This is a group of our friends, a group of our really good friends that we've made over years and years and years that all have really good skill sets. Mm-hmm. You know, every single instructor is a personal friend, and they're all really good at what they do. And they're sharing their skills with our other friends, essentially, you know. Right. And it's not meant to, you're not supposed to walk out of there and be an expert shooter, or walk out of there and be able to get into a street fight, or walk out of there and be able to butcher an animal.
You shouldn't ever
you should never try to butcher an animal if you've never done it before, you know. It's like all those things, but it should be exposure to those things, so you understand, you know, like our initial joke is these are all the things you should have done with your dad that you probably didn't. Right. You know, and it's but it's true, you know. It's like the first time I ever butchered a deer was with Jake, and I was 30. You know, and it was, you know, that was, I remember my mom trying to get me to do it when I was like 8, and I was so horrified. But it was, you know, it's a good experience, a good exposure, you know, and it's not dissimilar from the gym, that the exposure is what kind of identifies you, where you're like, okay, it's not what I'm good at, it's what I'm scared of or what I'm bad at that I need to kind of like either work through or work around. Because the biggest crusher at Vanguard is not the handguns, and it's not the oak horse, and it's not the knife fighting, it's killing the small animal, or it's going off the rappelling tower.
Yeah.
The heights.
Our mutual friend Eric Axel told me about. Yeah. So he did my chest tattoo.
Yes.
He's our jiu-jitsu training partner. He was talking about that and how for him it was such a big deal to get over the fear of heights with the rappelling.
It's huge. And you could not be with a safer group. The guys that do the rappelling, they do such a good job, but it's scary. It's scary. It's... You're so tired from walking up the tower because it's 100 feet up, so it's a good stretch. You get up there and you're in the wind, and you know you got these guys cracking jokes, and you're just like, I'm very overwhelmed. I'm very overwhelmed. It's like, no, you're in a safe space. This is a good safe spot, you know. Yeah. And it's so funny that everybody's terrified of that. Everybody's terrified of killing the small animal. It's humane, you know. It's fast and it's done, and you're gonna eat it later. And you know, nobody's scared of really the oak horse. Nobody's scared of the ranger rope. The ranger rope's just hard. You fall in some nasty water. I mean, it's gross, but you know, but nobody's scared of that. Nobody's scared of running around with a pistol and shooting things, you know? You should be scared of those things.
Yeah,
that's true. but again, it's creating that safe, space. Yeah. Just like the gym. I mean, if you, you could easily make that gym a very unpleasant experience for everybody, but why? You know, you could just as easily make it an incredibly positive experience.
Yeah, you can make it a positive experience where you're just like, you know, sure, the workouts suck.
Yeah.
But you're, you know, it's odd. Like, your attitude towards that is everything, right? Like, whether or not you see embracing the suck as something that is positive or negative, that mental switch is everything.
Well, and, you know, the work's not going anywhere. You know, like, that's, I mean, it just, the work's not going anywhere. You can get mad at it. You can get upset. You can get mad in any situation. But how you approach that work, we call it a workmanlike attitude. Yep. You know, you just go away and it's one step at a time. You just chip away at it. You know, it's just, it doesn't ever change. We had a couple of athletes do something that even I think is insane. They finished up a week ago. They ran the Pecos Challenge, but it's out in Big Bend, and it's in 5 days, they run 170 miles. So they run four marathons, then they run a 60-mile event, and they run 10 miles. And it's all unaided, and they're just out there in the desert. And, you know, I talked to them afterwards, and I was like, I'm so, without being condescending, I was like, I couldn't be more proud of you guys. I thought for sure y'all were going to die. But, and they're like, yeah, it's just doing work. It's just putting one foot in front of the other. Like, the training helped out.
Have you had anybody do the Texas Water Safari?
That's the canoe race all the way down
from San Marcos to the Gulf.
There's a few guys in the gym that have done it.
I really want to do it.
Yeah, it's you know, man, it's I've got a few friends that have done that, really? And it's
maybe we'll talk afterwards because I want to get hooked up with some people who've done it.
Yeah, it's that one's pretty interesting too because the you know, people die on that all the time from dehydration because they're
they die from overhydration.
Overhydration,
from hyponatremia.
Hyponatremia. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. That's definitely one that's a lot of being uncomfortable. You got to be really good.
Because there's snakes and there's alligators, and you have to pass like the canoe portages. And
it's portages. It's just sitting in that canoe all day too. Yeah. It's really uncomfortable.
Just throwing.
Me and Jake and I rafted the Grand Canyon two Januaries ago, and we did 226 miles in 9 days.
Yep.
And it's funny. There was never one really hard day, but you were at a level four of misery from as soon as you woke up till as soon as you went to bed.
I
did a similar
trip. I went from Moab to Lake Powell, which I think is a little further down the river.
Yeah, it was. We'd never rowed before. We were on a boat, and we had two kayakers with us that were fairly experienced. But it was definitely one of those things where it's like, okay, I'm glad I did it. I would be very hard pressed to do it again. Yep. You know, but it's and that's what those guys did that run race too. They're like, I'm glad I did it. Be very hard pressed to do it again.
Yep.
You know, but it's good to do those things. It's a comfort cleanse.
I like that term.
Yeah.
What's the strangest thing you've seen in the gym? I'm sure you've seen some wacky stuff.
I mean, there's so many. I would say for the purposes of this podcast, the strangest thing was I was not there. I had to actually go to South Texas for a funeral.
Yep.
And Jake went to go to Mexico for a wedding. Uh-huh. So we're both gone and we're both in the airport at the same time. And our phones start blowing up and we have all these missed calls and I'm communicating with Jake and then we're communicating with our other coach, but our second location, we had this small little annex shell that we kept all of our gear in that we'd work out in this big kind of parking lot. And across the street was a Section 8 apartment complex. And we never had any issues with the guys. They would definitely come over and talk or whatever, but it was never a big deal. It was always fine. But apparently there was a SWAT standoff. So somebody had a weapon in there. And so the SWAT team ran in while a class was going on for our guys, locked our guys down and used the gym as their HQ for the standoff across the street.
Wow.
And so they wouldn't let our athletes leave. So they locked them down and they kept them in there. And we shared this building with a tile company. It's a massive tile company.
Yeah.
And so they let our athletes stay in the rec room and they had a bunch of popsicles in the rec room and they kept our athletes there for like 6 hours.
Wow.
And so they ate all the popsicles. And so I came back to a very nasty note about eating popsicles. But that was probably
one of the more PG ones. I'm sure there's some other ones.
There's things that happen in the gym where you're just like, that really happened. But that one was definitely one where you get a phone call and you're like, because you can think like I'm in South Texas, Jake's in Mexico. And it's like, your gym is the location of a SWAT standoff. And you're like, really?
Yeah. And there's nothing you can really do about it.
Nothing you can do about it. Yeah. Nothing at all. Yeah. But yeah, Dan Dow was there that day. Yeah, you should ask
Dan's
him.
Dan's been with you guys for a long time.
Dan's been one of the very first athletes. Yeah, yeah. He's been at it for a long time.
Dan is a jiu-jitsu black belt at our mutual jiu-jitsu gym.
Yeah, and Dan's probably got a pretty good quote about it because somebody asked him the other day, like, why do you still do jiu-jitsu and why do you still do Atomic? And he goes, I have two superpowers, so why would I stop doing? I want to have those superpowers for as long as I can.
There you go.
It's like my fitness allows me to do the jiu-jitsu. The jiu-jitsu allows me to do my fitness.
Yeah,
he's
a strong, scary guy.
A scary guy.
great guy. But yeah
awesome. For sure.
Awesome. What's the number one lesson or piece of advice that you would have for people that you've learned in your 8 years and with your business that you would share with other people who are small business owners who are thinking about starting a company that you would want to share from your experience?
Know why you're going to do what you're going to do. And if you're going to do it for money, that's a hard one, man. It's you need to, people say this all the time, but do what you love and maybe you'll get paid on after the fact. But I mean, it's true. If you really, really like it, you know, I mean, Jake and I both bartended for the first couple of years that we were doing the gym. We had long, long hours, but you need to really love what you do. Cause that's going to allow you to consistently innovate it and change things. Always we call it programming in pencil, but if you become too in love with an idea, too righteous with an idea, it's going to come back and get you every single time, even if it's your identity, you know, it's right. What you base everything on. You always need to program in pencil and be able to work around that and do something else.
Cool. So
adapt
and be ready and do it not for the money.
Yeah. And you know, the other one is mentors, man. It's huge. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't, if somebody's willing to give you advice and not in the way of this is what I would do if I was, you know, but somebody's really willing to give you advice and mentor you on things, those principles are evergreen. I've noticed pretty much across the board, you know? And the, you know, huge thing with a mentor is not only things they do right, but things they do wrong, you know, and it's a big, big component. And it's a struggle, right? Because you're like, oh, I don't want to do things the way you did it. I want to do them my own way. Well, if the way they did it worked, you need to do it the way it works until it stops working, and then you can do it your own way. But if it's working, let it work.
Don't mess
with that. You can focus your energy somewhere else. Yep. And I think that's a pretty important clause because people wanna micromanage and own every aspect of something, and that's how you get a lot of average product, right? Versus you find people that are real good at what they do, and they do that, and then you do the other things that you're good at, and that definitely gives it, because you just can't be good at everything. Yeah. You know, we know guys that are good at a lot of stuff, but man, it just makes it so much easier for you. It makes you so much happier.
Yeah.
But I think that's a big, big component. And other than that, it's just put in the work, man. It never changes. It never changes. Make all those good habits and be consistent with those habits.
And I mean, it's crazy because you've seen, I mean, both with physical fitness and with the business, those good habits accrue, and then you see a big difference between the people that have those habits and the people who don't,
mm-hmm.
right? Like a lot of businesses that maybe are not doing as well, a lot of people who are maybe, you know, spent a lot of time eating nachos and not enough time, you know, picking up heavy stuff and putting it down. But those things make a huge, and they kind of accrue over time and they compound, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, and you know, good habits and bad habits, right? And it's, for me, like a lot of things, we talked about the cold shower thing.
Yep.
You know, you said you do the cold showers about a year. And I did that for a long time. And I the way I do most things now is I do it for an extended period of time and don't mess with it at all. And then I'll stop doing it. And has that improved? Is my life improved? Is it the same or is it worse? And if it's improved by not doing it or the same, then I might not add that thing back on. If it's worse, then I add that thing back on. So for instance, for me, the showers didn't have a dramatic effect on me. What had a dramatic effect on me was daily meditation because I have a busy brain and that allows me to kind of cloister things.
Yeah.
Another one for me that's been huge is just a small stretching and soft tissue regime that it's like, okay, if I don't do it, I hurt. Yeah. If I do it, I don't hurt. You know, yeah, it's just a few of those things. But I, we talked briefly about Toastmasters earlier. I thought that I would, Toastmasters is a public speaking forum. My dad did it 20, 30 years ago. I was like, I'm going to go do my 10 speeches. I'm never going to do it again. And I went, I did my 10 speeches and I didn't go back for a while. And it's just like another habit. You don't do it, you get bad at it again. Mm-hmm. So it's like, so now I just show up. It's just like the gym for me. Yeah. You just show up. I don't get too emotionally involved in it. If I have a good day, I have a good day. If I have a bad day, I have a bad day. But I have that habit of showing up. And that's, I mean, I think that's a huge, when you can just kind of train that thing, that there's not glory in any one of those things, right? Yeah. But it's just that consistent habit of why am I doing, what is my purpose in all this? Well, I want to be a better partner. I want to be a better husband, boyfriend, coach, just, you know, and it's not one thing that fixes that. It's a consistent habit, a consistent
thing. It's interesting. What the cold showers do for me is prevent me from getting too comfortable. It kind of trains your brain for that resilience. Like, this is going to suck. And then you do it. Actually, by this point, I'm a little bit over a year in of every day. And your body's used to it. Mm-hmm. It's like, it feels like about 70% of a hot shower.
And that's, you know, that's kind of what I noticed too, is you just kind of acclimate to it. Yeah. It's just like, oh, okay. This is cool.
That's what we're doing.
This is cool. Yeah. It's, another big one and this is one I struggle with, even though I love to write, is morning pages. Yeah. You know, when you get up and you write a few. Yeah. That's one that when you do it, it works, but it's a hard habit because it's really hard.
I haven't been able to keep that one up.
It's so hard. And it's one, I'm going to blame time on that one, you know, because it takes 45 minutes to write 3 pages.
Well, I suck even more than that, because I was doing 10 minutes of free write every morning.
Uh-huh.
And I stopped doing that.
Yeah.
So that's embarrassing.
It's hard. And it's, you know, it's funny. I go back to my dad, one of his best friends is a guy named Jim Phelan. Jim Phelan wrote a bunch of Howard Hughes books. And I used to like to write a lot. I still write a decent amount. And he's like, there's only, the only difference between a writer and a non-writer is a writer writes. That's it.
I love that line. That's it, man.
Yeah. He goes, it's...
I'm gonna put it on the fridge.
Yeah.
right next to the guitar practice quote I have, which is, I'm staying into practice because nobody's going to congratulate me on how good my drinking's got.
Well, that's pretty good.
I got that from another podcast guest, Seth Jones in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
So, yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah. But it's the same thing as jiu-jitsu, right? Yep. 90% of what you do is trash. You're there for that 10%. You know, it's like writing, 90% of the writing you do is just trash. It's just trash. Yeah. But it's that 10% that you're just like gunning for. And there's no guarantees on it.
Yep. Same thing with songwriting. I mean, that's a lot of stuff. But can you think of a time when things went really wrong in the business, and how did you handle it? What'd you do about it? I mean, the SWAT thing is interesting and funny, but that's not something going really wrong.
You know, we do a pretty good job. When I was first coming back from Jackson, my mentor up there, he had me go talk to a few people up there that had small businesses and partnerships especially, and what they did right and what they did wrong. And one guy, a guy named Dustin, he was 12 years in with his partner, and they were just starting to split the sheets. One guy wanted to take the company one way, the other guy wanted to take the other way. And he's like, I'll tell you what kept us through the longest is we discuss what could happen. What could happen? Like, and it's funny. He goes, it seems dumb, and it's one of these silly things. But it's like, hey, if what happens if this athlete falls down, or if your mom dies, or you know, we get pregnant or have a kid, And he goes, you don't need answers, but when they do happen, and these are things that could and will happen. But he goes, when they do happen, at least it's not fresh and new, and at least you have a point to work from. And we've done a really good job of that. When we got out of the habit of it, things kind of went wrong, but we've never had a real devastating issue. You know, we stay pretty on top of that stuff, but it's also the, I think there's still a little ego in what drives us. It's all for the betterment of the gym and the athletes. Mm-hmm. And there, you know, we follow our own rule where it's not individual recognition. It's all for the gym and it's all for the athletes.
That's awesome.
And that makes it a lot better. But I mean, I would say our biggest hiccup is we had a great coach and she was so phenomenal and she wanted to go start her own gym. And we're fully supportive in all that. You know, that's definitely one of those things that we're always, it's rising tides raise all ships. We're a firm believer in that. But we had not, when a coach leaves, they take athletes with them. And we did not, and we knew she was going to take athletes, but we didn't put an actual number on what that was going to cost us, right? And there's no, I would much rather have an athlete train with a coach they want to be with than be with me, for sure. So there was no hard feelings. But when you lose 15 or, you know, I think we lost 8 or 10 athletes to her, which is what we charge a month. That's like, oh man, we're down some cash. But the other thing, and this was big, is when there's turmoil, when mommy and daddy are fighting or there's turmoil at home, things slip through the cracks, people leave. And so other athletes left because there was this consensus that it was not a solid establishment. And I assumed through the course of her leaving, we probably lost like 20 athletes, maybe 22, something like that. And I thought they all went to her, and they didn't. Some of them just left, and they were just, it was just a kind of a way out. And that was a very teaching experience where it's like, okay, not only did we not put a number on what that was actually going to cost us, but any internal turmoil, yeah, it seeps through.
So your handling of it also costs you on top of it.
Yeah, and it that was a weird one. I don't know if those, you know, I haven't talked to any of those athletes since, so I don't know if they just were, that was a good excuse, time to leave, or, you know, there's so many things it could be. But it's but I just assumed they all went to her, and when, you know, I talked, we went out for coffee, and she's like, no, they're not training here. And it's like, really? They just, you know, it was just very, I was, even now, it's like, oh, okay.
Would you ever ask them?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
If you see them.
And Austin's so small, you see people.
Yeah.
But you know, the thing about fitness is it comes and goes, man. I never get upset, you know, that the employees leave.
Yeah.
Athletes leave. That's life. That's part of it, man. You should never guilt anybody to doing something new or trying something different. All of us try to fully support people as much as we possibly can. And it really only helps everybody out, man. It makes such a more positive experience.
Yeah.
And it's so cool to be able to look everybody you see in the eye. I mean, that's a good feeling. That's a really, really good feeling.
Building on that, what's your vision? What do you want to do this? So you guys just recently moved into that facility you have now, mm-hmm. less than a year ago.
And we just
big, very nice facility.
Yeah. It's about 16,000 square feet. And we just got the okay that we get another 2-year lease on that, which is, so we'll build that facility a little bit nicer. So we currently have the, we are combining companies. So we had 3 separate companies. So those are going to combine into one company. So we have our brick and mortar gym, which is, for the listeners, our gym is a laboratory. We, like I talked earlier, we run all these, we create these training programs and run, we have 200. And as of the other day, I think we had 240 day in, day out athletes. We have another 60 or so that kind of show up. But from there, after those programs are completed, we then sell those online with how well they've worked. We make any modifications we use. So we have a online presence that sells programs, t-shirts, gear, all those things. And then we have our consulting business, which currently works with SLC, Senior Leadership Course, and the Green Berets. And so those are all going to be combined into one company, with Jordan and Jake and myself. So that's been the first big tier. We're launching a new website at the beginning of the year, doing our own podcast. So we have, we've been slowly stacking.
What's the goal of the podcast? Who are you having on it?
We've had Hoyler on there. We've had Randy on there. We've had just a wide variety of people. So a mixture of both, just basically an excuse to sit down with people we want to sit down with.
Sure.
And also just share theory. You know, it's so interesting because it never, you know, our theory on training is probably not dissimilar from your theory on guitar. You know, it's all in jiu-jitsu. It's all so related, especially when you get into the martial arts with older guys that have done it for a while, mm-hmm. where it's like the glory is so long gone, and it's like, why do you still do it? It's like, well, what else am I gonna do? You know, this is who I am. This is part of my purpose.
You guys want to grow that online presence so people can actually go buy their stronger, faster, harder to kill.
Yes, shirts. For sure. Yeah, all the swag. Atomic-athlete.com. So okay. we have a bunch. We have over 75 training programs on there. We have a bunch of articles, blogs. We have videos. We've been compiling stuff for a long, long time.
And if people find themselves in Austin, where can they find you to come train with you?
3907 Warehouse Row. So you can just Google Atomic Athlete and you can come down there and see us.
Yeah, make sure you put it on the map because it's harder to get to than you would think because of the direction of the frontage road, right?
Nothing works. Yeah. Nothing works over there. It is definitely one of those things where
it's a great location, but
in theory
from here as a crow flies is actually pretty close. Yeah. I have to go all the way around. So.
Well, and somebody put a Chick-fil-A right next to a Starbucks, which equals one car wreck a day. You know, it really is a pretty interesting thing. But yeah, we always welcome athletes to come in and check it out. It's a fun facility. I mean, we take
so you
care
yeah of, you welcome drop ins, right?
Yeah. It's a good spot. But and if you don't want to work out, we got a bar. You can have a beer and just kind of hang out.
Yeah, or you can do both.
Like you can do both,
like we did on Friday.
You can do it all.
Well, Tod Moore, it's been an honor and a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for sharing your stories with me.
Thanks for having me, man. I appreciate it, Pablo.
Right, take care.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to Small Business War Stories. If you enjoy the show, share it with a friend, or you can subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or on our blog at blog.proven.com. If you have an idea for us, we'd love to hear it. Please email us at podcast@proven.com. See you next time. Small Business War Stories. Small businesses are the soul of America. And this is where they tell their stories. I am your host, Pablo Fuentes.